Lift your hands and begin to worship. Mashata kalala. Or calls me home. Hearing the power of God. Open your mouth and just begin to pray in the spirit. Lift up your hands. You feel his presence here. You feel his power here. You feel his anointing here. Father, thank you for Calvary. Thank you for redemption. Thank you for the resurrection. Here it comes. Calls me home. Here in the path of Christ, I stand. Till he returns, or calls me home. Here in the power.
Hey! Ikobadayaya. No power of hell can block you from his hand. No scheme of man can ever block you from his hand. Ikosetekepedagalaya. Ooh. That power of Christ is about to be released right now. That resurrection power is about to make a difference in somebody's life. It's about to change a story. It's about to break the scheme of man. It's about to break the power of hell. It's about to break something in your life that is not of God. It's about to break an ancestral curse, a generational curse, a family curse, an occultic curse. It's about to break diabetes, hypertension, cancer. It's about to break HIV, hepatitis. It's about to break anti-marital curse. It's about to break generational curses. Lift your hands up. When I say the name of Jesus, you scream, I receive. You are receiving the power, that same power of Christ in which you stand, the power of resurrection, the resurrection we came to celebrate this morning. And as you receive it, diverse encounters, diverse visitations, diverse healings, diverse deliverances, diverse liberation, something is about to happen. Let us separate. Father, let your power fall. Let the yoke be broken. Let the power of the resurrection be made manifest in someone's life. Let the change of story happen right now. In the name of Jesus, lift your hands high. And in the name of Jesus, at the count of three, you place the hand on yourself and scream, I receive. Everywhere around the world, in Zambia, in Lusaka, all the way to Nairobi, Kenya, all the way to Douala, Cameroon, all the way to Cotonou, everywhere, London, England, wherever we are gathered here today, the same power of resurrection is about to be made manifest in your life. It's about to change the story. It's about to bring the deliverance. It's about to bring the healing. Lift your hands high. Father, let it flow. High. Father, let the fire flow. When I say the name of Jesus, 1, 2, 3, you scream, I receive, and place the hand on your head, and the same power that rose Jesus from the dead shall visit your life, visit your family, visit our nation, visit the church, and every dead thing shall be made to come alive. Father, let the power flow in the name of Jesus. 1, 2, and 3. Of his power, receive the visitation of his praise. Father, we give you the praise. Father, we give you the honor. With your hands and give him the praise. Give him the praise. Give him the honor. Give him the adoration. Worship him. Honor him. Adore him. Without any doubt, something happened already. Healings, deliverances happened already. Clap your hands, all ye people. Shout to the Lord with a voice of triumph. How many of you experienced something already?
And he's alive. Amen. He's alive. Jesus is alive forever. He's alive. He's alive. Jesus is alive forever.
One more time.
He's alive. Jesus is alive.
One more time. He's alive. He's alive. Jesus is alive. One more.
Amen.
Give the Lord a big clap of hand and be seated in the presence of the Lord. That is how to celebrate Easter morning. Yes, give him the praise. Just let him know that we have not walked into this day just carelessly and casually. How many of you had an encounter, a healing, or a deliverance this morning? It's already happening. It's still happening. How many of you had an encounter, a healing, a deliverance, or something in the course of this session that you would want to share with us? Let me see your hand. Wave it. Can you stand up? An encounter, yes, stand on your feet where you are. You had an encounter, a visitation. Yes, wave it again while standing. All right. I'm going to give you the time to come out quickly at the end of the service, and then we shall have it. God bless you. In Jesus' name. Acts chapter 2, verse 22.
And I just want to be where you are, dwelling daily in your presence. I don't want to worship from afar. I just want to be with you. Take me to the place where you are. I just dwell in place forever. I don't want to worship from afar. Draw me near to where you are. I want to be where you are. Dwelling in your presence. Feasting on your table. Surrounded by your glory. In your presence, in your presence, that's where I always wanna be. Oh Lord, I just want to be. I just want to be with you.
Na 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 na. I just want to be.
Acts 2, 22 to 24. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you. There's power everywhere. Approved of God among you by miracles, wonders, and signs which he
he did by him in the midst of you, as you yourselves also know.
Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, you have taken and by wicked hands
have crucified and slain.
Whom God has raised up, having loosed the pains of death,
because it was not possible that he should be holding of it. Somebody say a loud amen. I am here to announce to you everything that is trying to hold you before today, the possibility of their hold on you is broken today. The grip of their hold on you is broken today.
You believe that? Shout the loudest amen. Speaking very, very quickly and sharply on recoveries and restorations by the resurrection. Recoveries and restorations by the resurrection. Our objective is to understand the restorations of the resurrection. And by way of introduction, I am going to draw your attention to five things. Number one, the crucifixion, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the central point of Christianity. It is the high point of Christianity. It is the central point. Christianity is not qualified to be called Christianity without the crucifixion, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 14, verse 7 to verse 9. Romans chapter 14, verse 7 to verse 9. He said, "For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For whether we live, we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living." That's the center of Christianity. That's what the gospel is about. The crucifixion, the death, the burial, the resurrection, and of course the ascension of Jesus Christ is the central point of Christianity. Number two, the same crucifixion, death, burial, resurrection, ascension of Jesus Christ is the power of Christianity. Is the power of Christianity. Is what makes Christianity powerful. Is the power. In Philippians chapter 3 and in verse 10, Paul the apostle said, "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death." That is the power of Christianity. Whatever makes the blind to see, the deaf to hear, a drug addict to be delivered, and all the kind of testimonies that we heard this morning, whatever made that possible is the fact of the resurrection. A resurrectionless Christianity is powerless Christianity. If Christ did not resurrect, there is nothing powerful about Christianity. Thirdly, the crucifixion, the death, burial, resurrection, ascension of Jesus Christ is the worst nightmare of Satan and his kingdom. The worst nightmare is the greatest fatality of hell. The greatest fatality. The deadliest blow that the Father ever gave to the kingdom of darkness. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, chapter 2 and in verse 6, it said, "Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that is come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom of God, which God ordained before the world unto our glory,
which none of the princes of this world, the principalities, the powers, the devils never knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. If they knew that the crucifixion was going to be their doom, was going to be the final blow that will render the devil, keep the devil where he belonged, they would never have dared it. The crucifixion, the death, the burial, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus Christ is the worst nightmare of Satan and his kingdom. The greatest fatality and the deadliest blow. Number four, it is in this light that the crucifixion, the death, the burial, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus Christ is a most confusing and contentious and confounding subject throughout human history. So much contention around it. So much confusion around it. So much perplexity. And Satan made it so because of the value and the power that is in the revelation of the resurrection. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14 to 15. You see Paul the apostle talking about it. He said, yeah, we have found. Now back up to verse 13. But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? Keep going. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is nothing. And your faith is also vain. Yeah, and we have found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that Christ rise not. Many religions of the world, they just fight the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, and they are just also confused about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it's just a confusion in their mind. But we know that Christ is alive today, because he does what he did when he was alive yesterday. Somebody say amen. It takes a living God to perform living and current miracles. Somebody say a loud amen. Somebody say a louder amen. And finally, the crucifixion, the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the ascension of Jesus Christ is about the rescue, redemption, and restoration of mankind. It's about the rescue. It's about the redemption. It's about the restoration of mankind. What did God do when he sent his son Jesus to die, to bury, to die and then be buried and then to resurrect, and then to be crucified and die and be buried and resurrect, and then ascend into heaven? It is about rescue. It is about redemption. It is about restoration. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13 and 14. The Bible said, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, as it is written, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. It's about rescue. It's about redemption. It's about restoration. Why? Man got hopelessly lost. Hopelessly. When Adam and Eve committed sin and high treason in the Garden of Eden, and they decided to move with the enemy of God instead of serving the God that made them. I believe that was in Genesis 3, I'm sure, verse 24, when God drove them out of the Garden of Eden. So he drove man out of the Garden of Eden, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. From that moment on, man stepped out of God's presence and stepped out of God's glory and stepped out of the garden and began to look for way. He kept on looking for way until the time where he decided to start looking back for God. And he began to look for God in every manner of way. Idolatry. He takes an animal. He says that he makes a golden image. He said that is his God. And began to look for God until God said, Since you cannot, the Bible says you cannot by searching find out God. Since you cannot find me, let me find you. That was the basis. Let me find you. You can't locate me. You are hopelessly lost. You have gone astray. You have messed up and you have missed it. And you have the consequences of missing it. But now, let me find you. And he sent his only begotten son to look for man and to locate man. Many people say, when I found the Lord, that is a good statement to make. In 1978, I found the Lord. In 1985, I found the Lord. It's a very good statement to make, but it is not accurate. Because you can't find the Lord. The Lord was not missing. He finds you. He's the one who locates us. He's the one who sent his son to search for us. Am I communicating at all? And he found us and found everything that was lost along with our loss. I announce to someone today, there shall be full restoration. If you are saying amen, say louder, amen. If you are saying amen, shout the loudest, amen. Give the Lord a big clap of hand as you take your seat in the presence of the Lord. So what? The objective of this study is to discover the things that were restored by the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. What are the things restored? What restoration do we expect? Number one is the restoration of the plan and purpose of God for mankind. The plan and the purpose of God for mankind that God corrupted. God restored by the release of Christ to die for the world. God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Genesis 1:26. That plan failed. And then John chapter 3 verse 16. God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. He sent his son so that the plan he had for mankind can come to pass. Number two is the restoration of the nature of God in man. The restoration of the original man at creation. The nature of God in man. When man sinned, man died. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And then chapter 6, verse 23. The wages of sin is death. God told Adam, the moment you eat this fruit, you shall die. Adam ate it and was still alive. Why? It wasn't the physical death. It was a spiritual death. The spirit of God in man died. Literally expired. And death is nothing but a separation between a separation. Separation of the spirit of man and the body of man is physical death. The separation of the spirit of God and the spirit of man is spiritual death. Am I communicating? So man become denatured. There's something we call the denaturation of protein in protein biochemistry. Where you turn on the heat on the egg, the white of the egg becomes the colorless egg becomes white because the heat changed the nature. It is protein, but it moved from one nature to another. The new nature has color. The previous nature had no color. The new nature had color white. Am I communicating? In the same manner, when man sinned, he lost nature. He became ordinary. He lost the supernatural nature. He just descended almost into an animal kind of life. But God brought Jesus Christ into the world so that we can acquire the same nature that we lost at creation. Somebody says a loud amen. Somebody say a louder amen. What was restored? Number three is the restoration of the glory and the dignity of man. That glory and dignity that was lost by the fall. The restoration of the glory and the dignity of man. All have sinned and come short of glory. We saw that earlier on in Romans chapter 3 and in verse 23. Psalm 8 verse 1 all the way to verse last said, O Lord our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou hast a mindful of him, and thou and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels. The angels, what angels, is Elohim, and has crowned him with glory and honor. There was a crown of glory, a crown of honor that was on man at creation. But when man descended, he lost that crown, lost that honor, lost that glory. So that the animals that man was ordained to tame and rule could become wild against man. But at resurrection, there was a restoration. Somebody say restoration. Because the Bible says Christ in you, Colossians chapter 1 verse 27, is the return back of that glory, is the hope of that glory that was lost. So there is the restoration of the glory and the dignity that was lost at the fall. Number four, what restoration? Is the restoration of the dominion and authority of man. The dominion. God created man with dominion. He created man with authority. That dominion was lost. That authority was lost. Genesis chapter 1 verse 28, God made man and God blessed them and God said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. God gave man dominion. Man lost the dominion. But when Jesus resurrected in Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 to 19, Matthew 28, 18 to 19, he said, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. All power. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. All power. I see somebody stepping into the realms of power here this morning. If you are the one, your amen will be the loudest. All the powers of your father's house and the powers of the occult realm of the witchcraft world that has tried to tame your life, today the power of the resurrection shall bring them into total defeat and frustration in your life in the name of Jesus. If you are saying amen, shout the loudest amen. Before this week is out, there is somebody here that shall experience the raw manifestation, that's right, of the power of God. And every monitoring devil that is sent to monitor your life, I declare they are set on fire. Shout the loudest amen. Number four is the restoration of the dominion and authority of man. Number five is the restoration of the relationship between God and man. Relationship. Man lost relationship. There was a relationship breakdown. Genesis 3, 23 and 24. And God, therefore the Lord's God sent him forth from the garden. There was a relationship breakdown. But when Jesus came, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 and verse 18, he said, therefore if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. 18, and all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. The major reason why Christ came is to reconcile God and man and God. That restoration happened at Calvary. Number six is the restoration of the presence of God to man. The presence of God. Man was driven, like we said earlier on, from the Garden of Eden. Beyond the relationship restoration, there is the restoration of presence. The restoration of the presence of God. Genesis 3:23, God drove man out. And before he drove man out, God visited them in the cool of the day. In Genesis chapter 3 verse 8, they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. God was always visiting them. But when man fell and was driven out of the Garden of Eden, they lost the presence of God. But when Jesus came and he died, Matthew chapter 27 verse 50 to verse 51, I hope I'm not too fast for you. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, he yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And the earth did quake and the rocks rent. That veil was housing the Holy of Holies that had the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord that carried the presence of God, the two cherubims, and carried the altar of incense and all of that. Only the high priest went there every year, once a year, once every year. But when Jesus died, he tore the veil. The veil tore by itself. The veil is like maybe 18 feet tall or 18 meters tall. That's a man's height is about 6 feet, 1 point something meters. Now consider 18 meters tall. That's a veil. And it was torn from top down, not down up. So it wasn't the human hand that tore it. Looks like God sent a tall angel to tear it apart. Am I communicating? The meaning of that is, number one, high priest, your assignment is over. You are not entering this Holy of Holies anymore. The final sacrifice has been made. Number two, anybody can enter the presence of God anytime. It is not only the high priest anymore. It's God speaking to somebody here. Anybody can enter anytime, anywhere. You can enter in your bedroom, in your bathroom, in your kitchen. You can just access the presence of God anytime, anywhere. Somebody shout the loudest, amen. Somebody shout the loudest, amen. Look at somebody by your side. Say, the veil is torn. Say, I have access. I have access. I have access to the presence of God. Anytime I want, I can step in there. Give the Lord a shout of praise. The restoration of the presence of God. Number what? Are we going? Number seven is the restoration of the voice of God to man. The voice. The voice of God to man. When man lost fellowship with God, he also lost the voice of God. Direction. Let's say direction. The restoration of the voice of God to man. He lost the voice of God, lost direction. We talked about Genesis chapter 3 verse 8. Where God was always coming to them, the voice of God, walking in the garden, in the cool of the day. When Jesus came in John chapter 14, verse 6, he said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, I am your direction, I am your information, I am your revelation, I am your life. That is why I came. So that you can have the direction you lost in Eden. So you can have the voice you lost in Eden. In John chapter 1 and in verse 18, the Bible said, no man has seen God at any time. He said, but the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. He came to reveal the Father to us. Somebody say aloud, amen. It's the restoration of the voice of God to man. Number eight is the restoration. Restoration of the blessing and the reversal of the curse of hardship, struggling, sweating. The restoration of the blessing and the reversal of the curse. You know, when man fell, God released the curse. In the sweat of your face shall you till the ground. But it came to reverse. That's Genesis 3:18. It came to reverse that curse of hardship and curse of sweating. Where he said, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. Genesis 3:13. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. Somebody say aloud, amen. So, can somebody say aloud, amen? What else is restored? Number nine is the restoration of liberty and freedom that is released from satanic bondage and enslavement. The restoration of liberty and freedom released from satanic bondage and enslavement. Galatians chapter 3 and in verse 13 and 14. Christ redeemed us so that the blessing of Abraham can come upon the Gentiles. Somebody say a loud amen. You know why? When we obeyed the devil, we came under his control. Romans chapter 6 verse 16. When Adam obeyed the devil, he came under demonic control. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves, servant to obey, he servants you are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. When Adam obeyed the devil by eating the fruit, he brought himself and the whole of humanity under the authority of the devil. But today, that authority is broken. That amen can be better. That amen can be better. Number 10 is the restoration of life, health, vitality. Life, health, vitality. Life, health, vitality. You are not permitted to be cut short before your time, like that girl. Like how the devil wanted that favor. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 4 to 5. Isaiah 53, 4 to 5. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, what he received at Calvary, we are healed. Matthew 8:17. Himself took our infirmities. He took our infirmities that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Somebody say aloud, amen. Somebody say aloud, amen. In case you came here sick or afflicted, the last symptom you felt shall be the last forever. Number 11 is the restoration of all lost privileges and opportunities through sin. All the privileges and opportunities that sin made us to lose, we regain them back by the arrival of Jesus. Romans chapter 8, verse 32. Romans chapter 8, and in verse 32. He that spared not his son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Everything that we lost can be gained by the resurrection. Number 12 is the restoration of hope. The restoration of hope. The restoration of hope. Christ in you is hope. Colossians 1:27. Christ in you is the hope. The restoration of hope. Somebody say amen. Look at your neighbor. Say there is nothing that is hopeless with God. There is nothing that is hopeless with God. They nailed him. Killed him, thoroughly buried him. Normal disciples would be hopeless. So this man that was so powerful, this is how everything will end. So what will we do with our life from this moment forward? And Jesus told them, if Calvary happened on Friday, don't give up. Because Sunday has not yet happened. The resurrection Sunday morning. That may be somebody here today. Maybe the devil thought he has finished something in your life. But I am here to announce to you. This Sunday. This resurrection Sunday morning. God will show you. That he has gone ahead of the devil. That he is senior to the devil. That he was the one who created the devil. Shout the loudest, amen. Let this resurrection Sunday morning be the restoration of your hope. That nothing is too lost that cannot be found in God. Nothing is too dead that cannot be made alive by God. Shout the loudest, amen. is the restoration of hope. Number 13 is the restoration of faith. Faith in the reality and authenticity of God's word. Because Jesus told them, after 3 days, I will be resurrected. And you can imagine what would have happened if after 3 days he was not resurrected. Their faith will be gone forever. Faith in the reality of the supernatural. He said it, he did it, he did it, he said it. Okamalea. Nitorino lesheje Oluwa. Nitorino lesheje Oluwa. Elesi elewi. Elewi eleshe o. Nitorino lesheje Oluwa. That is why you are called Jehovah. That is why you are called Jehovah. What you said you will do, that is what you will do. That is why you are called Jehovah. Talabafi yowe, talole ba odoba. Talaba fi owe talole talole ba odoba. Olorun to jolorun lo. That is the God where they pass God. Olorun to jolorun lo. Talaba fi owe. 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 Anybody whose faith is under attack, the devil says, stop going to church. The devil says, what has it profited you? After this resurrection Sunday morning, the world will see the profit of your profession. They will see the benefit of your faith, the benefit of your belief. You believe that, shout the Lord and say amen. The restoration of faith. 1 Corinthians 15 and in verse 14. And if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is vain, and your faith is also vain. And since Christ is risen, our faith is no longer vain. Somebody say amen. Amen. Since Christ is risen, our faith is profitable. Our faith is valuable. Number 14. Final. What do we expect? It is the realization of prophecy. The realization of divine prophecy is a form of restoration too. Bringing to pass what he said will happen. The realization of prophecy. He said the seed of the woman shall bruise the head of the serpent. Shall give him head injury. Head injury. And just give him some intracranial hemorrhage. Put him into some level of coma for a while. Genesis chapter 3 verse 15. He said, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. He shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. This prophecy was fulfilled when Jesus was crucified. And he put his head on the head of Satan and marched him through the corridors of hell, having spoiled principalities and powers. He made a show of them openly, triumphing them over over them in it. Somebody say a loud amen. Somebody say a loud amen.
Somebody say the loudest amen.
These are the restorations. How do you appropriate them? How do we appropriate these restorations?
Number one,
by giving, all right, let me give it as an instruction. Number one, give your life to Christ.
Let him own you.
2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 to 21 said, if any man be in Christ, is a new creature. All things are passed away, behold, all things have become new.
And all these things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us
the word of reconciliation. If you are in Christ, you are a new creation. If you are in Christ, resurrection happens for you. Number two, embrace the truth of the crucifixion and resurrection. Embrace the truth.
What you are hearing today should not just be to you ordinary stories. Embrace the truth. For ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The truth is that the death of Jesus healed you. So you reject the sickness. The death of Jesus freed you from sin. The death of Jesus gave you a relationship with the Father, so you can have the assurance of eternity with God in heaven. Embrace the truth. And number three, and this message is a kind of message that you should go through. I've preached other Easter messages that I have not gone over today. Some of them are reflected in some of the materials we have written. This is titled The Blessing of His Bleeding. Power in the Death and the Shed Blood of Jesus has details. This other one is titled The Cross, the Grave, and the Rise. The Cross, the Grave, and the Rise. That is, walking in the victory, the power, and the reality of Christ's resurrection. What happened when he died? What happened when he was buried? What happened in the lower part of the earth? What happened when he resurrected? All that. Embrace the truth. Study to embrace the truth of the events of the crucifixion and the resurrection. And finally, determine to live for him who died for you. To live for him who died for you. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and in verse 18. And all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation.